Hey folks, Kilt-Man here. Kilt-Man at your services. How are you all? I hope you're all doing very, very well. Now, in the previous video, I discussed Kilt-Man's favourite moments in cinema where some character goes, no! Or even just, no. But the impact of the word no and the revelations and the repercussions of that utterance across the cinema-going audience and the characters and their scenarios, and how powerful it can be. And of course, you know, it was a Leviathan video, went on for 2.5 hours. It did. And someone else said to me afterwards, like, oh, there's another thing you could do. Like, how about people going, you, in movies? That revelation, that shock moment where the mask comes off and they go, you. I thought, yeah, I can do that. Yeah, I suppose I can do that. And the leading light amongst all the people who mentioned that is Stevie Boy Doherty from North of the Border, North of Hadrian's Wall. He came up with the idea as well. So I thought, yeah, okay. Now, this is not going to be 2.5 hours long, I hope. And as I always do in these sort of listing videos, as I always say, I don't do a top 10. I don't do a top 20. I don't want to be limited to things like that. Guess what I've gone and done? It's a top 10. But I've kind of cheated because my number one slot, the film that occupies the number one slot, has 3 great uses of the word you. And so we'll get to that in due course. Now, this is not a health drink, by the way. It's making me feel pretty fine right now. I'm drinking Baileys, yeah, Baileys. Christmas isn't even here. To me, Baileys is a Christmas drink, but it's bloody lovely, it is. Cheers, y'all. And yeah, there's ice in here. And of course, you know me and whiskey. Never, 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 never put ice in whiskey. This is a whiskey. This is a little seasonal heart warmer. So you put your ice in, two big chunky blocks of ice, and you glue your Baileys on top of that. And wow, it is lovely. You know, it's chilled. It actually warms you. Creamy, lovely. Cheers, y'all. So, right. You. In these moments, there's a few which are, you know, you, but there's some where it's conversational, but again, the impact is all that matters. It's how it's delivered and how it sticks in your mind. Now, I only really thought about this in the last couple of hours and thought, oh, I can do this. So I've compiled a list and I've done it. I'm on these big blocky chunks of paper. My usual little notepad thing has gone AWOL. The spooks probably took that. So I'm on these great big like canvas pieces. And once again, no matter how big, you know, the paper is, my writing is still ridiculously small and massively unintelligible. So no matter what I've written, I can't even read it anyway. So, but let's endeavor. And right, so we're gonna, it's a top 10, but so our first one up, it's in, you know, the other order. So the 10th one is the best. And right, we're gonna start off with Conan the Barbarian, and you're hearing Basil Poledros' score right now of Conan the Barbarian. For John Milius, Arnold Schwarzenegger as Conan the Sumerian. There is a terrifically great moment in this, but there are many great moments, of course. Conan, we see him as a child losing his mum and dad, and like he wants vengeance, you know, two snakes coming together like this. You know, and he wants to go after Thulsa Doom, James Earl Jones. And but James Earl Jones is Thulsa Doom, the leader of yet another snake cult, because they're all the rage, you know, in the Hyborian age. And he's got two fabulous henchmen, two bodyguards, Ben Davidson as Rexor, and Arnie's bodybuilding mate, Sven Ole Torsen as Thorgrim. And Sven Ole Torsen's in many Arnie movies, always playing a bad guy, you know, an opponent. He's also famously in Gladiator. He's Tiger who fights, is his name Tiger in it? I get confused with Gladiator because it's one of my favourite films. I got tattooed from it and I have a lot of props from the movie. But way before the film came out, in my first anthology book that got published, I wrote a story called Arena. And it was based on the true telling of the savagery of the Colosseum. And although mine wasn't set in the actual Colosseum, it was actually in some other, provincial arena. But I told a very violent story, and my opponent went up against a guy called Tiger Rhinus. Not Tiger's anus, Tiger Rhinus. And it's a colossal bout of sheer bloodletting and violence. And then I wrote that. That was published in 1999. And then in 2000, Scott's movie came out, Gladiator. And you've got tigers patrolling around, and Maximus has to fight a guy who's Sven Ole Torsen, Tigris of Gaul. See, it finally came to me. And I thought, you ripped me off? That was my story? I did genuinely think that. I'm sure Scott didn't give a toss about what I wrote. He's not even aware of it. Oh, that's great, that. Anyway, let's get back to the point. Conan has been tasked with getting King Osric's daughter back from this snake cult led by Thulsa Doom. And he infiltrates the snake cult. And they do a bit of robbery first of all, which is what brings them to the attention of King Osric. Oh, these guys could actually do it. He's with Valeria, his queen, of course, and Super Tie, surfboarding champion Jay Lopez. Super Tie, Archer. Thief, and wolf fodder for the wolf witch as well. And they break in, and Rexor's doing this thing, Davidson, and Ben Davidson. He's got the big snake and all that, and all these women, all these scantily clad nymphettes, all parts of the ritual stuff, and they break in there, and, Arnie kills the snake. And later on, when he infiltrates the actual coven in the big sort of mountain hideaway, he gets sussed. He steals another guy's robes in a very questionable scene. You're a very big disciple. This guy puts the moves on Arnie, who's acting all naive. Maybe we could go and talk about it in my tent. And Arnie fucking takes him down, gets his robes. But all the henchmen of Thulsa Doom suss him, and he's caught and beaten and held to the ground and then crucified on the Tree of Woe. But of course, Thulsa Doom's accused him. You killed Rexor's snake. He's very fond of his snakes, But when he gets recovered from that, Mako playing the wizard, all the incantations, because Conan's close to death, and they drive out the demons, and he starts retraining with his Atlantean sword, and then he go on the quest to the Mount of Doom? Or is that from something else? Is it the Mount of Doom? Oh, I can't remember now. The Mountain of Power, that's it, the Mountain of Power. God, is this Bailey stronger than I thought it was? I mean, this is diluted. It's not like a proper bottle of whiskey, it's massively diluted, but it's got some potency, for sure. So anyway, they don the war paint and they infiltrate, and you've got the orgy taking place. You've got Thulsa Doom rather clumsily becoming a giant snake, who then slithers off down a tunnel to safety. But the princess is there, and they would endeavour to rescue her. But they've got a commando style get in there. They've got the war paint on, and they sneak into this big orgy ceremony taking place. All these big marble pillars and people writhing about having fun. And the meal gets brought in a great big huge cauldron with these strange baldy fellas, all chanting as they bring this thing in. And then he starts stirring this horribly green broth around, and you see suddenly there's hands and heads and things. My God, they're cannibals! But we've already seen the kitchen. And the little body's hanging upside down. and they're getting skinned and filleted and all that kind of stuff by these Michelin chefs. These Hyborian Michelin chefs. And it's cannibalism. But they get in there and fight, look, we've got to get this girl. So like, fuck this. Now we've snuck in, let's take these bastards down. So there's people getting their throats slit and like getting the hilt of the sword in someone's face. Sandal Bergman as Valeria is looking amazingly graceful with those uber long dancer's legs of hers. And lots of chaos ensues. Arnie, right, fuck this, gets the big cauldron of body broth and shoves it down the steps. Boom, 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 crashes down. Heads and limbs go everywhere. You know, right mess, kind of clean that place up afterwards. And, but Thorgrim and Rexor come in and like they've both got massive, massive axes and huge, you know, ancient weaponry, which only bodybuilders could wield. And Ben Davidson, who's about 18 feet tall, as Rexor, sees Arnie and just goes, pretty big axe, you. Like, because you're the one that killed my snake, you're the one we beat up and nailed to that tree of woe, and you're back again. Well, Arnie always said, I'll be back. And he said, you. Oh, God. I damaged my throat doing a no in the previous video for Martin Riggs, Mel Gibson's Martin Riggs, and my throat's not recovered from doing it. I kid you not. I did some damage there. So that's my stage opera career over and done with in a flash. There's some real whiskey. See, this will help the throat. But it's a great moment, and of course, a battle ensues there. Great big marble pillar will come down, and it gets between Rexor, it hits Rexor, boom, it knocks him down, like that. And then Thorgrim, Sven Olli Torsen, manages to pick his mate up, but in all the cloud of dust, the marble dust from this fallen pillar, Arnie and co. have gone, and that's it. But then it's all queued up for the big battle of the mounds at the end of the movie, where Arnie, Conan will kill both Thorgrim and then Rexor at the end of the movie. Anyway, so that's the first of our you moments from Conan the Barbarian. The next one is, right, oh hang on, because we do need to hear this, don't we? Because this is the actual battle sequence from that scene I just described. Big cauldron goes over, lots of people get sliced and diced, you know. Basil Polidorus' main Conan theme comes in. In faster, pure action mode. But that's enough of that, because otherwise we're going to be here all sodden day. So, okay. Let's go on to our second one. And we're going to need some James Horner. And we're going to go for... this is Aliens. Yeah, Aliens. Well, where's the you in there? Get away from here, you bitch. You could have had that. That's not what I'm thinking, though. What I'm thinking requires... this. And... Lance Henriksen as Bishop. I prefer the term synthetic person, you know? And they're on the Sulaco. The Sulaco, you say, Kilt-Man? Yes, the Sulaco. And all our crew, our colonial marines, have woken up from hypersleep. And it's breakfast time. Another glorious day in the Corps. And they're all there. And, you know, I guess the lieutenant's, you know, too good to eat with the rest of us grunts. You know, it's cornbread, son, it's good for you. Eat it. And you've got Bill Paxton as Hudson, Private Hudson. And he says to Lance Henriksen, who's the synthetic person, the robot, Ash is a goddamn robot. He says, you know, Bishop, do the thing with the knife. And like, Lance Henriksen's like, oh, please. And he's like, no, go on, Bishop, do it, do it. So and he offers up his commando dagger. Now, I've done videos on aliens before, and I cannot for the life of me remember if the knife that's used in that sequence is a genuine Fairbairn Sykes commando dagger. It might be, it looks like one, but I haven't rewatched the scene, and I can't remember what details I got of it in the first place, but it's certainly a commando dagger. And I know commando, I'm tattooed with them, and I use them. So, he gets the knife, aren't I? Because he's going to do this thing with the hand, like that, stab between. You know the scene of me. And so, go on, Bishop, do the thing with the knife. Oh, please, go on. But Drake, he's one of the, you know, he's the big guns, I forgot what they're called now, bloody hell, with Vasquez, his cap's on sideways and all that. Like, and he grabs Private Hudson's hand and puts it on top of Bishop's hand. So it's like, don't move. And like, Hudson's like, Bishop, no way, man. No way, man. Not me. But Drake, Mark Rawson just goes, yeah, you. As he leans over, yeah, you. Don't move. And Bishop begins his, it gets faster and faster and faster. See if I can do this. I don't know why I always do shit like this. Oh God, why do I do that? Why do I go and hurt myself? It ruined it by bringing the hand up. Oh, who cares? It's a great scene. It's a comedic scene. It also reveals that Bishop is an android. And Ripley doesn't like androids, does she? But it's a great sequence. It's comedic. It's exciting. The way it's sped up. And Bill Paxton's face. And then finally, it's done. And Bishop gives him the knife back. And he's like, it wasn't funny, man. And like Drake gives him his breakfast plate back, like his tray. Yeah. Eats up, pats him on the shoulders. Stunned. And of course Bishop has cut his own finger, so a bit of synthetic blood comes down with that weird coagulant gel that runs through their veins. But it's a nice, you know, yeah, you, because Drake's a brick hard bastard as well. Like, he and Vasquez together are a kill unit, you know, extraordinaire. And the smart guns, of course they can't use the smart guns, but they still lock and load. Yeah, shh, just keep it quiet. Who's firing in there? You know, I give orders, you know. Because the whole thing is a thermonuclear installation. Oh dear. As Carter J says. But yeah, so that's my second in this impromptu list of just the use of the word you. Because it was cool in the movie, and it's, you know, yeah, you. And imagine, Drake was a big guy leaning over your shoulder, yeah, you. You're like, ooh, mommy, Bishop, look after me. Do you know what would be great playing over that sequence would be? You knew I was going to do this. I can't believe I fucked up with the edit, the severed hand there. By using my actual hand to bring it up. Now, you imagine this playing over that. Bishop's countdown, of course. Let it build. There we are. And like, Hudson's face is like, Bishop, no! Yeah, you. Especially now. I wish I had the guts to do it. I really do. But you know how clumsy I am. Dun dun. Yeah, I don't know why I'm doing this either, but a bit of fun. So, that was our number two. So let's go for number three. Now this one, I'm gonna, I thought of this one quite early on, and I thought, I bet no one would ever have thought of this, but it's a good one. And let's get on to the music for it. And the only bit of score, well, bit of music for this film that I have is from the trailer itself. And that music is quite famous. You're gonna get it right away when I start playing it. Because for many people in the UK, this is the Channel 4 news, the news theme. Done by Alan Hawkshaw, and it was a piece of music called Best Endeavours. And Channel 4, in their infinite lack of wisdom, commissioned it, and he did it, and it was their opening theme. And they forgot to copyright it. So Warner Brothers, when they were doing Pale Rider, Clint Eastwood Pale Rider, this was the music that played in the trailer for Pale Rider. And it became quite famous because of this music. Now, Pale Rider is a great, great Western. It's one of Clint's revisionist Westerns, which he'd been doing since the early 70s. You know, things like The Beguiled and Outlaw Josie Wales. You know, and he'd come out of spaghetti Westerns. I don't think he ever did a conventional American Western. He always re-evaluated it, made them more realistic. And Pale Rider, again directed by Clint himself, tells the story of the town of La Hood and that county, and it's like prospectors there, but La Hood, played by Richard Dysart, Dr. Copper from The Thing, is corrupt and he wants to drive out the good people, and he's got thugs working for him, beating them up all the time and destroying their prospecting rights and all that, and ruining their parties. They're just all round bad bastard. And but someone arrives to save the day, help them out. A mysterious stranger, played by Clint Eastwood, who in a great sequence whilst bathing reveals that he's got 6 bullet holes in his back. The scars of the exit wounds of bullet holes in it. Like, he comes to dinner, but he's got a dog collar on, which hence why he gets called Preacher. And he's great with a wooden stave as well. Richard Keel, Jaws from Spy Who Loved Me and Moonraker, is in this, playing a guy called Club. He was he's called Club, but he's a thug. And but Clint will take him down with a wooden stick. Nice piece of hickory, you know. Takes him down with a fucking blow to the balls. And I think he takes a few other guys out as well. But the whole thing will culminate at the end of the movie. Like, you've got, what's his name? I wrote this down somewhere. Stockburn, played by John Russell. By the way, I did stab myself in the hand there. I actually did. And I'm trained with knives. I'm deadly to anybody, but more especially to myself. And Stockburn has arrived. He's a corrupt marshal, and he's got his gang of deputies there. They're all dressed like Pinkertons with the long, you know, trench coats on. And they're all using things like this, like so. But Preacher goes into town as well and takes them all out one by one. And it's great. This is an army cult. Clint uses a navy cult mostly in movies, but he has used these, but he doesn't use this in that movie. And he's killed all the deputies, and then he walks down the street towards Stockburn. He was just there, and Stockburn's got that sort of Lee Van Cleef angular face, sunken cheekbones and all that, and a tash, and he's looking under his hat at this guy and approaching him. And Preacher he's got a couple of guns, and he's taking the chambers out and putting new chambers in. And it's a great sequence of just clickety clack clack clack, sort of, you know, the metal mechanics of a gun, and his spares are jingle jangling with every step that he takes. He's just took these guys down using stealth and guile, and yet he's how could he move anywhere without the jingle jangle them bloody spurs? And like, as he gets closer towards Stockburn, Stockburn suddenly sees his face underneath his hat, underneath the preacher's hat, because he looks up like that, and he goes, "You." And like, it goes for his gun, and preacher puts 5 bullets in his chest, and the camera goes to behind Stockburn, and we see the 5 bullet holes in the same pattern as the 6 bullet holes, was one missing, remember, on Preacher's back. And then, he drops to his knees, but he's not dead yet. So he goes for his gun again. "You! Again, you get a second, you!" And Clint just goes, and he does that thing, his eyes roll to the back of his head. And down he goes. Now, when Preacher was described by other people to Stockburn, Stockburn actually says, "He reminds me of someone, but it can't be. He's dead." Because as Clint says, Preacher is a ghost. He's done High Plains Drift, a very similar thing. Clint plays the Avenging Angel, getting revenge for his own death, of course. And Pale Rider is a very similar story, but it's wrapped up in like ghostly mythology, because it's not explained who he was, where he came from, but he's there for revenge and he helped out. He wanted a guardian angel, these poor beleaguered prospectors, and they got one in the shape of Clint Eastwood. So, and you get 2 U's in that as well. It's the first with the hat reveal. "You," because he obviously, "I know you because I killed you." And then, and then Danny goes for the gun again. "You." Down. Brilliant. What a great bit of music. I mean, to many, that is purely Channel 4 news. But there's a Western feel to that. You can see why Warner Brothers took that and went, that's perfect. It's not in the movie. It's just a trailer. But it's become synonymous with Pale Rider. So, there we go, that's 3. Alan Hackshaw did that. Right, okay. Did I say this wouldn't take too long? I lied. Right. Okay. Do you know something? All of these entries are from the 80s. Now, that wasn't on purpose. And I was, when I looked it over again before doing the video, I thought, there's nothing from the 70s, nothing from more modern day. They're all 80s movies. It's the era that I most love, of course, but in terms of movies, music, and every damn thing. Come on now, come on, when is it? Let's go to... And this is Basil Poledouris again, who scored Conan the Barbarian. And this is for Paul Verhoeven. And it's RoboCop. Let's move on a bit. Peter Weller as Officer Murphy, Detroit, the wild, futuristic Detroit. Police are on strike, gangs run everywhere, and it's just, it's hell on earth. And he gets destroyed by Clarence Bodiger, Kurtwood Smith and his gang, who blow his hand off and blow his legs off and shoot him in the head, and he should be dead, but they manage to bring him back and, you know, repurpose him, and he becomes RoboCop. But he raises memories, but he was partnered with Officer Lewis, Anne Lewis, played by Nancy Allen. Gorgeous, lovely, delectable Nancy Allen, who found his body, or witnessed his murder, but she couldn't get to him in time at the hands of this gang. And but RoboCop goes out on the streets and becomes an instant crowd pleaser, you know, and hated by the criminals, and he terrifies the arse out of them all, because he doesn't pull any punches, and he's got creepy metal fists as well, you know, chrome and titanium. and he kicks ass with that fucking big gun of his as well. So, but in a great moment, because Officer Lewis begins to, he reminds me of, it's Officer Murphy, it's Peter Weller. You can tell by his chin, and the way that he spins his gun around, because Officer Murphy had a son, and used to watch Laser, Cowboy, Cop, whatever his name was, on this TV show. He used to spin his gun around, so his dad learned how to spin his gun around as well, as the Detroit copper. So Robocop does the same thing. So Nancy Allen, you are Officer Murphy. And she gets a moment to stop him in the corridor in the Detroit police station, whatever precinct house they're in. And he's like, drunk, 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 drunk. And she's bringing a perp in. She goes, Jerry, just take him in. I won't be a minute. And she goes and chases up to the Robocop. She goes, okay, we haven't met, but I'm Officer Ann Lewis. Do you have a name? And of course, Robocop's just standing there he says, can I help you, Officer Murphy? He goes, no, that's not really what I meant. Do you have a name? And he's like, what does he say? He's just doing nothing. And she goes, Murphy. She leans in, and we're seeing through his viewpoint, sort of, you know, how he views about the targeting systems and all that. And she leans in, and other people are beginning to realize, hang on, she stopped him. She's his ex-partner. You've got to get her away from him now. We don't want him remembering. And she leans in and says, Murphy, it's you. It's you, Murphy. It's you. And the revelation is, because he takes a step back, because she does get through to him. And there's a few more yous in it as well. I did write this down. She goes, you really don't remember me, do you? You really don't remember me, do you? And of course, he comes back with a great line like, excuse me, I must go. Somewhere there is a crime happening. Kajum, 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 kajum. But it's in there. It's in there. And now he's remembering. He begins to have more memories, and he goes back to the family home. Oh, it's agonizingly sweetly haunting and beautific that this rampaging metal avenger, who's still got a human soul, you know, and still got memories. Here we are. This is Murphy goes home. And he has the memories of his wife and his kid. But what is it he says? I can see them, but I don't remember them. Something like that, anyway. God, this is good, you know. Is it Christmas already? But it is a great moment. Murphy, it's you. And she's trying to appeal to him, you know, get through this metal facade, all these directives, you know. Fabulous moments. In a film of immense brutality, carnage, and rife with satire, there is a human heart at the essence of Robocop, which is why the film is so damn successful. Robocop 2 has its moments. I love Robocop 2. Then you got Robocop 3, and then you got some TV fucking bullshit and animated shows. But Robocop, the original, is definitive. And that is a great pivotal. Murphy, it's you. She's getting through all of this programming that he's had, and she's breaking through to the essence of the man that was once there. It's fantastic. But we can't stop with that. This is where he breaks into Clarence Bodigan's having a big drugs deal taking place with a rival gang. So you've got about 40 armed men in there, maybe more, but Robo knows where they are, so he's coming through. And he's targeting everyone. And even in the big Rob Bottin designed that suit. Rob Bottin from The Thing, of course, and Legend, and Total Recall. Also Paul Verhoeven. And he had the big battle. Dead or alive, you are coming with me. Oh, fuck you. He just stands there taking hits. And then... and then he'll beat the shit out of Clarence. But Clarence is also owned by OCP. OCP runs the cops, you know. And spits blood in his visor. We're going to move off and we're going to go back to something very familiar because this featured in our No as well video, and let's get on to it. And it is Mad Max 2, because we have a great U sequence in this as well. We're in the wasteland. Max has encountered Papa Gallo, Mike Preston, and his gang of Gucci Arabs who are refining ka-junk, ka-junk, ka-junk all day long. Refining it they are. He's met the gyro captain, Bruce Spence, and they've sent out scouts to try and find... They've got a big tanker full of guzzoline. Big tanker full of guzzoline, but they need to be able to drive the thing out. They've got to find a rig big enough to hold that fat tank of gas. And... But the scouts do not fare well with Lord Humongous and Wes and it, and all marauders who are outside who give chase, kill some, rape others, and then kill them, and then capture some other ones who will then be tortured and beaten. Oh, horrible stuff. But Max has seen a rig already which can haul that fat tank of gas. So he gets in there, makes a deal with them. Look, I'll bring this back to you. So he gets out there. He's got his shotgun. The cartridge is a double-barreled, sawn-off shotgun. But the cartridges are dead most of the time. They just crumble to that. They fizz out when he fires. They don't even bloody work. But he will go out and get that rig and drive it back to Papa Gallo and his encampment. But to get there, he's got to drive through all the bad guys. So you'll have... Well, I think this would be... Technically, it's the third of all the chases in the movie, but it's actually probably the second really exciting chase that we get. He drives through the camp, and like they all get on their bikes and their dune buggies, and they go after him. And you've got the gyro captain who's got his snakes, and he manages to throw a snake down into one of the gay boy berserkers who are like police-helmeted, leather-studded road jockeys. And they've got like, they're firing darts from this amazing dart thing on the back of this pickup truck. And the snake hits this guy, he's like, spins the gun around and quills the driver. And one of the great stunts, which people always overlook, this car makes a hell of a leap into a ditch full of, you know, wrecked, other wrecked vehicles. And there's a dummy in the back which goes, whoa, boosh. And it's the guy with the snake who's in charge of the dart gun. But Max will get in there. They pull the school bus, which guards the entrance. They drive that back out the way. And he comes speeding in, driving the rig. But Wes has got on it with a couple of other guys are on the rig as well. And they sound like, Wes is like, They've got into the promised land. They've got in to the compound. And then you get the Ronnie Barker lookalike, who's in a pink Cadillac, all souped up. And he's in pink. Pink helmet on. His beard and everything's all dyed pink. He's the pink boy. And as he gets there, the school bus gate's been driven back, so he's like, oh! And they've got wall-mounted flamethrowers. And he can't get away in time, and they flambe him. Bye-bye, Ronnie Barker. He's a dead ringer for Ronnie Barker. But in the meantime, like, Wes has got in, and Wes runs rampage through the place with his little butt cheeks on the show, with his arse cut out of his leather pants. And it's great. Max will take a couple of guys out as well. And the warrior woman slits a guy's throat. But Wes leaps around, does that amazing headbutt. He does the massive sort of flying through the air, spinning somersault thing. And then grabs... That was Roxy the Wonder Dog knocking something over. Cheers, y'all. And cheers, Roxy. Thanks for that. Oh, no. I'm out. But he does this flying somersault thing, then gets this guy who's got the mad spiky hair and does that cartoon-like massive boof headbutt. And you see a cartoon splash on the screen for a nanosecond, like a lightning blast, and then chucks the body over the side, kills him. Then the gyro captain lands in there, actually hits Wes. Wes has got his wrist-mounted crossbow, and it actually hits Wes. Oh no, hang on, it's Feral Kid with the boomerang, hits that and it knocks it aside. And then gyro captain comes in his little gyrocopter, and Wes does another bit of acrobatics and athletics and like gets out of there. And as he runs out, Max is there with the flamethrower on the major entrance, and like Wes just goes, yeah, I'll hurt my throat again, you can run but you can't hide. And it's brilliant. You can run, but you can't hide. It's fantastic, and it really sends shivers down his spine. And Max is just there, like, watching it. Because they've met before. Well, this is now the second time they've met. Because he meets in the actual opening sequence as well. We'll get into all that. So, but Wes recognises him. You. So you've got in this sequence, it's recognition. You. I know who you are. I know you. That reminds me of Mad Max, the original Mad Max, with Johnny the Boy saying to Goose, you know, and we know who you are, Bronze. We know you. We know who you are. Or whatever it is. So there's another one. There's another Maxi Youism takes place. Anyway, it's a great moment. And it's still a good excuse to play a little bit more of a... Shoot the tire. And that dickhead leans in with a little pin on his gauntlet and gets dragged under the wheels. Listen to that, and get some more babies. Yes, I'm well aware this one's overrun already, and it's also gone to rack and ruin several times already, but hey! That's life, folks. Life in the fast lane. Not much ice left in that, so that's even creamier than I expected. That's Wes.
You can run, but you can't hide.
Fantastic. You can't hide in the wasteland. Anyway, we're going to go on. But we're staying in the wasteland, believe it or not. Because... Come on. That's the dart that goes between Max's legs, and the fellow just looks at him, and Max looks at him like, blows the guy away from inside the door, then the guy at the top of the cab, the Wes jumps down with a spiked mace. Bear claw comes through the back window of the cab with his claws, his steel claws, and rakes Max's shoulder, but gets anchored in there as well. slams the brakes on. And you think it's the end of Wes. Au contraire. Right, anyway. We're going to Mad Max Beyond Thunderdome. The sequel that pretty much we all wanted, and it wasn't what we expected. Now, I've covered this movie a fair bit. You all know I love Mad Max 2. I love all the Mad Max movies. But I do really get a kick out of Mad Max Beyond Thunderdome. It's adventurous, it's more imaginative, it goes a lot further into this whole new expanded universe. Tina Turner's phenomenal in it. Angry Anderson's great. Angelo Rossito was master and he got blasted underneath and all that. It's great. It's watered down violence-wise, but you've still got plenty of action in it. It's a lot more comedic in many ways, and it's two stories combined into one. What's his name? George Miller. We'd lost George Ogilvy, who died during a scouting mission, a helicopter crash. George Ogilvy and Terry Hayes had two ideas. A Lord of the Flies style movie of kids in a wasteland having to get along together and form a new race of people, and also a Mad Max story. And then they're like, this is too much, we can't do these two films. Why don't we just combine the two together? It's a Max will meet these tribe of kids and become their saviour. And that's what he did. But it dropped down a certificate, it dropped down the violence, and a lot of people didn't like it. I love it. It's not a patch on the first two, but it's a great film in its own right. Anyway. This is the fabulous chase at the end. They're in a train on a track, and all anti-entity, Tina Turner and all their crew are all barreling after them. And with their mock Mohicans, which are coming up. It's a Mohican helmet that they wear. It's strapped on. So unlike in Mad Max 2, where they actually had Mohicans, like Wes in particular. But you've got Bruce Spence, who played the gyro captain in Mad Max 2, is in this movie. He's also got a bit of aerial hardware. He's a pilot again. He's got one of these weird sort of amphibious planes, and Max encounters him right at the very start. Max has got like a camel-led sort of a big vehicle and a sort of trailer and a tent system going on there. Super long hair and he's a pure nomad. And out of the blue, Bruce Spence comes in with his little son, both wearing pith helmets. And they knock Max off his jalopy. But in so doing, the Jedediah, as he's known, Jedediah, the pilot, will drop onto Max's stuff. And having knocked Max out and left him on in the desert, they drive off with that. So they are marauders, they're highwaymen, literally highwaymen, because they're up high in the sky, and that's how they do their attacks. And they live in this gorgeous, this sort of tunnel system, like a warren. Like a prairie marmot warren, full of all the things that they've robbed, and they're living a life of apparent luxury in the wasteland, as you know, the best you could do. And Max will re-encounter him after having gone through Thunderdome, two men enter, one man leaves, and all that, and then encountered the lost tribe of kids, and then taking them back to Bartertown, and then with Master from Master Blaster fame, rescued him, and you're going to lead him. The Promised Land, which turns out to be fucking Sydney, a dilapidated Sydney with ochre tinted clouds and skies. Doesn't look very appealing to me, to be honest. But anyway, cheers, y'all. And cheers, Scrubby. I know you live just outside Sydney. I'm talking Sydney after the big boom, you know, not like it is now. So you have this big, massive chase on the train. Anti-entity and everyone gets there. They want to get Master back because he's the brains about Bartertown. So they're trying to get him. Max will keep saving the day, snatching him back from them. Uncouple the other carriages of the train in this sequence and run with Master onto the actual engine itself. and they'll reach the end of the road. It literally is, the track just stops and there's a mound of earth. And there's this little kid, it's Jedediah's son, is there. And like, I think he's got two rifles, his pith helmet.
Stop! Nobody move! Or they're dead men!
You know? And like, they're all like, looking at him, this little kid with a big pith helmet on. Like, oh, we're dead, are we? And they all look over their shoulders. And there's this ferocious horde, sand dunes pluming up because all these vehicles surging down. And like, the kid just goes, oh no, looks like we're all dead men. Or all dead meat, whatever he says. And he pulls up like the hood of the rear bonnet of a car. And underneath is a rope, there's a ladder going down underground. And he runs down, scuttles through. Dad, we're all dead men. Dad, we're all dead men. And Bruce Spencer's there going like, oh, yeah, whatever, son. Yeah, whatever. Yeah, fine. And then suddenly Max and all these feral kids come through. And this is the moment, of course, that Joe's coming to. Max just goes, he sees him, and he goes, you. And like, Jedediah just goes, me? He goes, yeah, you. You've got a plane. I have. And the kids already started the engines of the plane. So you hear, I was going to do the rotor blazer. You hear the engines. And like, Bruce Spence just goes, Max, it might just save your life. It will. So they have to board the plane to get away. And they do, of course. But Max will be left behind. There's too much stuff on board. So Max ends up making a self-sacrifice and charging in one vehicle, charging all anti-entities, marauders, and somehow managing to make them all crash, which is a bit bizarre. I don't know the physics behind that. That can't possibly work. But it gives them enough time to take off. And like, little Angelo Rosito, as Master, just goes, gives a salute. And Max is lying there, as he always will be, broken and damaged and bleeding in the sand. And Auntie just comes up to him like, well, ain't we a pair, raggedy man? So long, soldier. And that's kind of a good payoff, because Master doing a salute and Air saying, so long, soldier. It kind of ties up that he's a warrior, you know, of the wasteland. But that moment, you, me, yeah, you, you've got a plane.
I have.
And I like the way that it's Bruce Spence playing another airborne guy character, the gyro captain, and yet the two. They're not the same. He's not the same character that he was in Mad Max 2. And I like the way that George Miller does this. George Miller throws you off. All the Mad Max movies, they don't really fit together that well. There's lots of things which don't add up between movie to movie to movie. And then of course Fury Road, nothing's. It's what the hell, you know? Everything has changed. It's Tom Hardy for one thing. But it doesn't matter. It's this cinematic, bizarre universe that he's concocted. You're going to get all the vehicular mayhem you want and crave, and the insane characterizations and absolute mad bastards who are out there. I was competing with that then, weren't I? I was out shouting. Look, folks, I know this is inane as hell. You know, how can you do like a big video on like all the cinematic no's, and I'll do a big video on the cinematic you? Well, you can, because it's just giving us a chance to talk about these movies and have a bit of fun as well. Like, so, what number was that one? Oh God! All right, we are moving on slightly in genre. Let's go on to. It's definitely here somewhere. Right. Yep. We're going on to another third movie in a franchise, like Mad Max Beyond Thunderdome. We are now on Army of Darkness, which, as I always say, should have been called The Medieval Dead. Why, oh why they didn't do that is beyond me. Don't get it, don't understand it. They dropped the ball there. Again, directed by Sam Raimi, and there's a couple of different versions of it, of course, but we won't go into all that. I've covered this movie a lot. We've got Bruce Campbell returning as Ash, beleaguered Deadite battler from Evil Dead 1 and 2. And again, these are movies which don't follow the same. They're not exactly the same. Evil Dead 2 is a sort of almost a remake and then sequel of Evil Dead. And then you get this, which is a different thing again. You've got the girlfriends are always played with different people, and the circumstances have changed slightly. And this one's played more for laughs. Again, like Mad Max Beyond Thunderdome, it drops down a certificate. I don't know, in America, it might still have been an R-rated movie. But whereas, obviously, you know, Evil Dead was unrated. Evil Dead 2 was R-rated, I think. But in this country, we drop down certificates from, like, X's, then to 18s, to, like, just a 15, you know, for this. Because it's not gory, is it? But Army of Darkness has a legion of fans. I love it. But I think it's quite a flawed movie. It's more of an ode, an homage to Ray Harryhausen. And for that, I applaud it. But it does pretty much take out a lot of the horror and go, we don't really want to use you this time. They're going pure action and mythology and, you know, Skeleton Army, it's Jason the Argonauts, but you've got a boomstick. And you've got a big fucking rotor blade chopper on the front of your Oldsmobile. It's still great. He's gone back in time. He's opened the Necronomicon, the Book of Time. The spells have been recited at the end of Evil Dead 2 to open the vortex. And he's gone back. He's gone back to the time of a rather bizarre version of Arthur. A King Arthur. In the Californian hills. It kind of reminds you of The Sword and the Sorcerer, which was filmed in the same sort of area as well, which is meant to be, I love The Sword and the Sorcerer, and it's fantastic, but it's got a similar feel. Army of Darkness and that sit together, they're good, you do a double bill, they're great to watch together, they really are. Anyway, so he's gone back in time, and he's still lost a hand. He can have a chainsaw, but he's got his chainsaw there, his boomstick and all that. And he meets all these medieval types who don't trust him. He defeats the She-Hag. He then gets given the quest, go and get the Book of the Dead. You've got to recite these lines. And it's Julia Dukas scores fantastic, actually. Danny Elfman does the March of the Dead theme to it as well. But it's a great score. Cheers, y'all. God, this doesn't last long, does it, this? No, indeed it doesn't. It does not. So off he goes. And he will encounter, of course, he's on his quest now. It's like his knight's quest. And he'll go to the old windmill. He'll be attacked by the mini ashes. Then he will encounter evil ash, which will grow out of him. You know. Your goody two shoes, your goody two shoes. And poking him in the eyes and all that. And then suddenly, shotgun comes up. Ain't that good? Boom! And he blows this bastard's face off, like, who does a 10 somersaults and lands in the grave. But then we'll rise up, of course, and form the Army of the Dead, which is what they're trying to avoid. But he's been told, look, go get the Book of the Dead and recite these words. And of course, the words are Klaatu, Rada, Nikto, which is the warning to which Michael Rennie, in The Day the Air Stood Still, directed by Robert Wise, way back in 1951, they're the climb down, the shut down, don't kill anybody orders to Gort the robot, played by Tom Locke, Marshall Locke, something like that. All 7 feet seven of this guy played Gort the robot, Klaatu, Barada, Nikto, or the shut down, you know, decommission yourself and don't kill anybody orders. So as a little reference to that. They're the words. Now, before anyone says that, oh no, in Army of Darkness, the words are Klaatu, Varada, Nikto. Yes, I've seen this, and it's not the case It's Klaatu, Barada, Nikto. It's a direct lift from Robert Wise's movie. And they are the words from Robert Wise's movie. Anyway, that's my new shit for you there. And so he gets this cemetery. And what the wise man didn't tell him, there's actually three books on this stone altar in this gorgeously elaborate cemetery, this Gothic cemetery. And he's like, what, three books? He didn't say anything about three books. You know, just get the book. Oh, you're filled with all that, all these words and all that, like, all this bullshit. But he didn't mention about three books. So we've got to try to work out which book he's going for. It's just great. So he's like, right, okay. He's got to get the book and then say the words. Grabs the book and suddenly this book just opens up and drags him in. And he's like, he gets his arms stretched out and then he gets pulled in there. Whoop, and the book shuts. Silence. And then suddenly the book begins to bubble open again. Like an ash comes out of the book. But it drags himself free, but his face is like 20 foot long. It's got a big horse's head, you know. And, you know, Bruce the Chin Campbell. Well, they played a massive joke, riffing on Bruce Campbell's own face anyway. So his chin is out there like that. So he's like, and his face transforms again, and he's back to normal again. And he's like, right, he just goes, wrong book. And then he's got two to choose from. So he's like, he's thinking about it. And he goes for one, then he goes, oh, I'll go for this one. And then he pauses again. He goes like, and goes for that book again, which sprouts a mouth, fucking bites his hand, then flies. It sprouts wings and flies around. It's biting him on the back of the head. It's fucking going for him. And he's screaming his head off. It's hysterical. And then it goes, it closes, lands flat again. And like, you got Bruce Campbell, and this is the moment, this is the you, which I love about this. He just goes, ooh, you. You. I'll get back to you. Campbell is so good at this, so good. Ooh, you. it's hurt him, and it's set him up again. He's fallen for it again. It's just superb. I'll get back to you. I mean, okay, that's the you element talked about. He still fucks up the lines, of course, because, okay, well, this is the book. This is the right book, then. So he goes for that one. Right, okay, yeah. Klaatu, Barada. And he's like, Klaatu, Barada. It's definitely an N-word. He's forgotten the Nikto part. He's like, I've got to say the words right, otherwise it will bring up the army of the dead. He's just got to get, all he's got to do is get the book, say the right words, and it's all going to be great. Because Ash is a dickhead. So he's going like, it's definitely an N-word. Necktie. Nepalese. I don't know, I'm making words up now. Under his breath, he goes, noodles. Right, okay. You see, he formulates a plan. Right, there's a way around this. Yeah, okay. I'm going to say the words now. Klaatu, Barada, Nikto. Nothing's happening. He's like, well, there you are. I said the words. Now, takes the book. Fucking all hell breaks loose. All the skeletons start coming up. He's opened up the land of the dead, and the army will rise. The skeleton Ray Harryhausen homage will rise to do battle. And then you get the humongous, fantastic final sequence, and lots more slapstick as well. But that's the you from that. Like, oh, you, I'll get back to you. Genius. I do love it. Do love that one. So we've done 7. Wow. There's only a few more, folks. Ish. Oh, okay. Well, this one will be quite quick, to be honest. the appropriate music. Music maestro, if you please. It's Alan Silvestri. It's director John McTiernan. It's Arnie Schwarzenegger again. And it's that bloody Predator. The first and best are never going to be beaten, Predator. Well, where's the you in that? Actually, now I've just said that, I can think of one early on in the movie which I didn't think of to begin with. Someone said you were the best. Dylan, you son of a bitch. Ah, oh, I could have used that, couldn't I? Well, okay, I've thrown that in as a little extra, a little aside. Dylan, you son of a bitch. General, we are a rescue team, not assassins. And all they do is assassinate everything in sight. Everything, everybody, even half the jungle. They just completely chew the whole thing up for no reason. They can't even see what they're meant to be shooting at, but just kill everything. We're not assassins. Oh, yes, you are. Your actions tell a different story. Right, anyway, so you've got Dutch and his team. Dutch, Schwarzenegger. I've got to go in and rescue, you know, some good guys from this friendly little, you know, South American country. And General R.G. Armstrong, who's awesome, sends them in there. But they've got Carl Weathers, who used to work on Dutch's other team on different missions. So how can you pass on Libya? It wasn't my style. You got no style, Dutch, come on, you know that. Why'd you pass? Yeah. General, be a rescue team, not assassins. I've gone back full back to circle. So they go in there to go and rescue these guys. Of course, the guys have been killed, the guerrillas have got them, and you know, but Carl Weathers, Mac, what's he called? What's his fucking name in it? Dylan, you son of a bitch. He's working the CIA, so he's got another mission in mind. They know it's going to be a major invasion. You know, we just stopped that. You know, you used us. I used you to get a job done. You dropped the six of us into a meat grinder. You know, but the Predator's going to pick them off one by one. Mac, Bill Duke, and Carl Weathers, Dylan, have not got along at all since the start. And they will end up running together to battle the Predator. Ramirez, Poncho, as he's known as well, Richard Shaves, a genuine Vietnam veteran, US Marine Corps recon, as was, Jesse Ventura, Jesse the Body Ventura, a governor and a wrestler, but he was a Navy SEAL in Vietnam. So the only two actual military veterans in that team were those two. But they at least knew their stuff. And Blaine, as Jesse Ventura, he's Mac's best mate. Of course, he gets wasted, gets his guts blown out, wounds all fused and cauterized. What the hell could have done this to a man? You know? Yeah. I love Predator. Any excuse. And so obviously, you know, more and more of them get picked off. They've got a hostage, they've got a prisoner. Anna is with them. And Dutch realises, like, you know, don't give it a gun, whatever you do, because the Predator didn't kill you. You know, you went armed, no sport. You know, and so you get Richard Chaves, they build a trap, all the booby traps with claymores, you know, and everything like that. Everything, all mechanics. The Predator can see it. They know that they can see it. So let's build things and camouflage it with leaves and all that. Like, and they build like a great big sort of air. He puts his foot in there. This trap will close and spring him up into the air. And it fucking works. It actually genuinely works. But they forget about the Predator's got this big plasma cannon on his shoulder. Bursts his way out of there. And the other trap they had was a log which was going to come swooping down and smack the Predator. But of course it does come down and it smacks Richard Chaves, Poncho, Ramirez, boof, right in the chest. Oh, you know, he's all busted up, Major, you know, and they've got to try and, I can make it. Well, no, you weren't going to make nothing. And they managed to drag him away. But Mac has seen it, and Mac, because he's killed his best mate, and he runs after it. I'm gonna get you, I've got everything a trucking guy needs. I'm gonna get me some fun. And off he goes into the jungle. And like Dylan just says, you know, like, he realises, look, I've got a lot to own up for here, and I've got some of your men into shit, and they've died. And you're never gonna forgive me, but at least, look, I can go get this thing back. It's not your style, Dylan, you know. We can make the chopper. No, look, you just get your men to the chopper. You know, you just hold on to that damn chopper, he says, like, because he goes off. I'll bring Mac back. So off he goes as well. And of course, you get the great tense sequence of Dylan. It's like, you know, going through this jungle, this claustrophobic jungle. And like, the predator could be anywhere. And suddenly, and we know it can mimic voices. And we know it's done it before. And we hear, you know, Dylan, over here. Which is exactly what the predator picked up from Mac earlier on. So he's like, there's two Heckler and Koch machine guns, like submachine guns, edging forward. And as he creeps down, suddenly an arm comes out from the bushes and grabs him. And he's like, and it's Mac. And like, Mac just goes, over there, past them trees, I see you. And as he looks, and he's pointing, he's got a hold of his gun, but he's also pointing at the same time. And a little bit of Dylan does this thing. He sort of like looks at him in the eyes, and then looks at the hand and the gun, and then looks at the finger, and follows the line of the finger. And then you see the Predator in its camouflaged, you know, morphing system on a big sort of bough of a tree, and his eyes, you know, and then he goes, yeah, I see it. Yeah, you can get this thing back. You know, both got scores to settle and all that kind of shit. Like, but the point I'm making is, he goes like, it's a wonderful you. It's like, over there, past them trees, I see you. It's been cloaked the entire time. Like, I see. And he's like, yeah. And in the cinema, when I first saw it in the cinema, it was a wowing moment. I was always alone when I saw that movie when it first came out there, because no one seemed to know about it when it came out in the UK. I was looking forward to it, but anyway. Of course, it's now legendary. One of the best action, mystery, suspense, sci-fi, horror movies ever. But that sequence is, the tension rises, and then it becomes like, well, here we go. This is Dylan trying to find Mac. A tiny little bit left. Still have a bottle over there. Half a bottle, you say, Kilt-Man? It's a lovely stuff, you know. I've actually absconded with the ice now as well. So you've got all this Silvestri creeping about stuff, which is great. Bill Duke's amazing, like, and Mac is a great character. Same kind of moon, same kind of jungle. You and me walk out on top of him, not a scratch, not a fucking scratch. Another one I got you, bro. He's gonna come back. I'm gonna carve your name into him. And then he kills a great big warthog. Jeez, you can have something bigger. Fuck you, Poncho, fuck you. this is them creeping round to try and take out the predator. And the pred fucking knows what's going on. It's just sitting there going, oh, Jesus. Ah, oh, come on, you bozos. I'll let you get a bit closer. And of course, Max sticks his head up. He sees the little targeting, the three lights targeting, and goes, if it's on your shoulder, like, don't fucking stick your head. It's quite clearly a laser targeting system. Boosh! And of course, Dylan hears that explosion, but it's kind of like it's muffled and he's like not sure. He's still got his two MP5As and he's there. With that awesomely chiseled physique that Apollo Creed has got. I mean, yeah, you don't want to be Arnie, but look at Carl Weller's. It's more athletic, but my God, the definition, he was shredded. Cool. This is where Dylan gets it now. We've gone beyond the U, haven't we? A bit here, but what the hell? You creep through again. Mark. Mark. And then you'll see. Well, it's a curious shot because you've clearly seen Bill Duke. Mark get his brains blown out because his brains come flying into the camera, into our lap. And but he sees Bill Duke's lying there, like his head upside down, and there's not much damage to him at all. You're like, your head's blown apart, isn't it? Turn around. It's like that. And you hear the little predator chuckle as well, like. And we all know what happens. His arm will get blown off, like. And it's such a clever thing because they kept the tricep and the bicep and the vein. If you saw the cinematic version and you got the first VHS and Betamax prints of the movie, you could quite clearly see when he turns around and gets the other submachine gun over and the Predator's running around, you can quite clearly see that Carl Weathers' real arm is there and the fake stump's there. From DVD onwards, they took that away, so you couldn't see it. But if you're in the know and you were there at the time, it was you can see his real arm. Oh no, didn't destroy or dilute the effect of that sequence one iota. And of course, yeah, he gets his arm blown off, and then it gets whoosh, skewered. But yeah. Them trees, I see you. Fantastic, great moment. Right, we're moving on to something which, again, you wouldn't have expected. He says, and now let's just see. Another 80s catalyst moment for director Stuart Gordon, producer and writer Brian Usner. It's Reanimator. Jeffrey Combs as Herbert West, Reanimator, based on H.P. Lovecraft, of course, based very loosely. And he's got his mate, Bruce Cabot, plays his mate. The medical students, of course, and you've got the unbelievably gorgeous and still unbelievably gorgeous Barbara Crampton in there as his mate's girlfriend, who of course will have a living severed head going down on her. Plentiful gore, Richard Band's score, which cheekily rips off Bernard Herrmann score for Psycho. They've got this serum. Herbert West has found this serum which can rejuvenate the dead, bring them back to life. And in the opening prologue, of course, he's found, are they in Germany or somewhere? I'm not even sure where they are now. And it starts screaming, and the police arrive like, you've killed him. I didn't kill him. I gave him life. And he's got that glowing serum, which is a brilliant, brilliant touch. And of course, it was a miskatonic and a pure Lovecraftian realm. And they're working for Halsey, who's the dean of the university. But they're working for Dr. Hill, David Gale, who's outstanding. And, and of course, they've reanimated a body in the morgue, which then springs to life and attacks the dean. And kills the dean, but they bring the dean back to life. And because he's gone mad, they put him in a sanitarium. But Dr. Hill comes to visit Herbert West, like down in his basement, and threatens him. He can use mesmerizing. He's also a hypnotist as well, which is such a bizarre concept. And he's like, I want this. We both know that the Dean Halsey is quite clearly dead. I don't know how you did it. I want your secrets. I want you to give it to me, and I will become famous for using this. You. But tell me now, otherwise I will just incriminate you completely. And he puts the mesmer there and all that. Like, so anyway, they go down to the basement in their student boarding, and Heather West is trying to give him, look, I've got no way out of this. So I'll show you the serum. And this is like, dead cat. He's brought a dead cat back to life already. That did not end well either. Because the dead don't ever come back in a good frame of mind, do they? In all these movies, all the Romero stuff, the Lucio Fulci stuff, the dead are never happy. Oh, I'll come back to life. Oh, I can go meet my friends again. No, they want to eat brains. They want to eat everything. They're just shambling ghouls. They're never happy, are they? Look at Pet Sematary. As Herman Munster in that says, sometimes dead is better. Well, of course it is. You're meant to fucking die. And in this, they come back with a fucking rampage. They're pure rage mode. And but you've got Herbert West reluctantly having to, look, this is cat remains. And I just put some serum on there. And you can see what happens. And Dr. Hill, David Gale, who's great in it, I love it, I love him actually. He's like, I love Jeffrey Coombs as well. And he's like, oh yes. And in the meantime, I'm watching the rejuvenation of cells taking place under a microscope. Herbert West goes and gets a big fuck off shovel, and whoa, boosh, there was a massive end of Psycho 2 moment. Boom, back of the head, and Dr. Hill's on the deck, and then you get a great, the fucking shovel's going through his neck, and his body's jittering away, and he presses down and scoots the head off, and he's thinking, hang on, parts, I've never done whole parts. I always thought there's a strange line, I've never done whole parts before. You're not a whole if you're in parts, are you? But anyway, so he gets the head. He puts it in a paper tray. The head won't stand up and all that. Well, it's got no feet, has it? So I think it's a paper clip thing. Yeah, like a spike. Puts the head on that, and the head's there. And he gets the serum and he injects it in the back of the nape of the neck. Like that. And then does the decapitated body lying on the deck, does that as well. Have we got the actual meat? We have, of course we have. It'll be this. And he then waits with his pen, tapping his pencil. And Dr. Hill's eyes open. In fact, I think the way they do it, the way that Stuart Gordon directs it, Herbert West looks over at the body on the deck behind him. And in the background, you see Dr. Hill's eyes open and look at him, like, and he turns back, right, okay. So, Dr. Hill, and I'm laughing because I thought it was outstanding this moment. Dr. Hill just goes, West. He's still got his vocal cords, you remember? His throat's still there. It's stupid to know, but, you know, West. He's like, Dr. Hill, can you tell me what you're feeling? What you're thinking right now? West. You. But West is writing it down. You. And in the background, the body, his old body has got up and is walking slowly behind Herbert West. He's going, you bastard. And the body gets up, grabs him and fucking knocks him out. Boof! And then, of course, the head goes on the rampage and causes all sorts of absolute chaos and literal carnage, you know, in the medical center of the university and all that, and the morgue. But it's just, West, tell me. You bastard. Fucking love it. It's genius. I've been chopping and changing from Baileys to normal whiskey, and I don't know, I feel great. Cheers, y'all. Barbara Crampton, who starred in many of the Stuart Gordon movies, she's in From Beyond as well, and Castle Freak and all that, with Jeffrey Combs as well, who's in many of these movies. She has just done one with Heather Graham called Suitable Flesh, which I actually really enjoyed. It's it is a brand new Lovecraftian, well, yeah, loosely Lovecraftian tale. There's a fair bit of sleaziness and carnage in it as well. I will cover that at some point. But Reanimator, I've yet to do, and I've promised to do it, a video commentary on this, because I love the movie so much. Bride of Reanimator, not so much. Screaming Mad George's effects, yeah, the big spider eye hand running around, I don't know. It's not that good. And then you Beyond Reanimator, which is beyond fucking stupid. I hated it. It just has no atmosphere whatsoever. There's no feel to it. There's no giddy joy to that movie like there is to this movie, which is so OTT and riotously gory. But fun, proper 80s, splatty, moist, over-the-top, chaotic fun, but with great OTT characters. Anyway, so, that was, well, we've now reached the number one slot. So, let's get on to the music from this. It's a horror film again. And it's one that you guys all know so well because I've covered it a million times on the channel. But this is where I've snuck in not one, but I think three U's. And where is it? I've got to get more on the ball with this. Jack. On the moors, we were attacked by a werewolf. I hate the way he says that. A werewolf. It's not werewolf. There's no I in werewolf. It's werewolf. And if it's Young Frankenstein, werewolf. There, wolf. Now, as I say, there's three examples, and you're all thinking of one of them right now. I know you are, but there's more. I'll do them in reverse order. Sorry, the husky just choked on something there. I've told her not to eat that. It's fucking plastic, for God's sake. Right, we all know the story of American Milk. God, I'm not going into this. I'm not going into it. So, but I did. Right, look. You've got when Jack first comes to visit David in the hospital. And he's like, you know, lovely breakfast there. You don't get breakfast like that in hospital these days. That looks great. That breakfast looks... I'd love that. Don't get anything like that in hospitals these days. Anyway, but David's not really in the mood. He's got no appetite. He wants raw meat, doesn't he? Fresh, raw meat. But Jack suddenly appears. Griffin Dunn suddenly appears with the waggly bit of skin. The skin flap, like that. And he tells him, you know, out on the moors, we were attacked by a lycanthrope, you know. It's like, shut up, will you? You know, they've had a bit of repartee, you know. His funeral was great and all that. And what's the girl that he wants to? I'm talking about a girl you want to fuck, you know. Yeah. There's nothing mediocre about Debbie McGee's body. That's one for the English fans there. And the business. She looks amazing at her age as well. That's the last magic trick that Paul Daniels ever pulled. He must have given his life to keep her permanently young. Anyway, so Jack's got to convey what's going on. Look, I was killed by a werewolf, an unnatural death. Now I'm cursed to walk the earth in limbo. You ever talk to a corpse? It's boring, you know. But like, what's the line? The werewolf's bloodline, the last werewolf's bloodline must be severed. The last remaining werewolf must be destroyed. It's you, David. Shut up! Nurse! But it's such a pivotal moment. It comes... You've had the funniness and the bizarreness and the supernatural oddity of a rural community who turn their backs and have weirdness. The attack on the moors, you know, stick to the road, keep off the moors. Oops, beware the moon. Oh shit, what is that? It's a sheepdog. Sheepdog. What else is on the moors? He didn't howl. No, but he was on the moors. So you've had all that, and then the shock and the dreams and all this stuff, and then Jack comes back and suddenly everything turns really sinister and really serious. And as he says, like, you know, the last remaining werewolf must be destroyed. It's you, David. And like that's my first of the yous from this movie. And it's a great one. It's a genuinely powerful, pivotal moment where you're learning about the real plot and the darkness that's going to inhabit this movie. And I'm playing Elmer Bernstein's fucking phenomenal, very sparse score for American Werewolf, because a lot of it's all, you know, moon-related pop songs, like Blue Moon, Bad Moon Rising, and stuff like that. But you know, a Moon Dance. I'm not going to play any of those, because I love Bernstein's score. I think it's actually really, really good. I wish there was more of it. There is the entire Metamorphosis cue, which I've got. It'll come on at some point. Which was not used because he played, you know, Blue Moon again, you know, which I think was Landis was going for, like, look, what you're looking at is horrific, and I'm going to make it more horrific by playing something jovial and fun. If the music was enhancing that, it won't be as effective. I think that's what his thinking was, and it definitely is a classic scene with Blue Moon playing there. But having said that, I do love the absolute dynamite aggression of Bernstein's Metamorphosis score, which doesn't fit with the rest of the lyrical quality of the rest of the movie score. So I can kind of see why, and maybe another reason why it was removed. But either way, it's a great piece of music in its own right. So you've had the first, well, it's not the first. We're coming to my favourite of the yous in American Elf, because there's more. So, we're going to fast forward David's been on his kill spree. He's killed all the poor bloody down and outs, you know. And he's killed the yuppies, and he's killed Gerald Brinsley on the underground. And I can assure you, this is not the least bit amusing. I shall report this. He's a civil servant. He's what a 1970s. It's filmed in 1980, 81, but it's 1970s style. And you know, got punk rockers there and all sorts of stuff like. This is not the least bit amusing. I shall report this. And then, good Lord, when he sees it, see you next Wednesday. He's on the tunnel wall of the underground, and our big wolf, Kestrel Wolf, goes after him and gets him on the elevator. Tremendous scene. I've talked about this ad infinitum, ad nauseum, I should say. But when they meet him in the Soho porno theatre to watch See You Next Wednesday with Brenda Bristles. and he meets all the people he's killed, because Jack's called him in there, like, you know, look, we've got another full moon tonight, you've got to take your own life. And they're all going to give him suggestions, as to, yeah, can't say I'm pleased to meet you, Mr. Kessler. All these poor old guys, you got devoured. And you'll be a couple of dead police to see him. Hiya, hello. And they're all chewed up. But you got Gerald Brinsley. We thought we'd keep him in the shadows because he's still a fresh killer, but it's still pretty messy. He killed them all the night before in the same stretch of time. They're all going to be messy. Why would he be, well, particularly nastily messy? But anyway, he's there. And you've got to kill yourself and all that, like, and he'll come up with ideas. But the line is, Gerald Brinsley just goes like this, with a bloody finger pointing, and his face is all, and he does come out of the shadows, and he just goes, "You must die, David Kessler. You must die, David Kessler." He doesn't say it twice. I'm repeating it just for the sake of, like, the "you" bit. Because you're all forgetting why I'm doing this video in the first place. It's yous, and why they're so pivotal. "You must die, David Kessler." And you got poor David there as well. It's like, look, I've got no idea what to say to you. You know, you've made my wife a widow. You've made my children orphans, you know, and all that. I didn't mean to. It's not my fault. It's a really bizarre dilemma. You know, I may have said it before, talking about American Werewolf, is that there's another way of telling the story where all the real emotion and the long drawn out elements of the torments and the dread of it happening again and dealing with it all could have been put there. Landis does enough to convey the horror, the tragedy, the comedy of the whole thing as well, the absurdity of it all. It was massively there, with a bit of slapstick and comedic lines and all that. There's tons of it. The film is rife with it. But he does get the emotion as well. But it's a 90-minute movie, and it's, you imagine it now, making that movie now. And I'm sure some people have wanted to do so, try to remake it. Everything would be egged on. Every scene would be even longer and longer, and yet probably nowhere near as nasty. The carnage would be taken out, and it'd be CG as well. So, you know, don't do it. The film itself is damn near perfect as it is, as a horror comedy. It's got just enough of every element, but I'd love to have seen more of, like, the actual thinking about the second night's full moon. But anyway, but "You must die, David Kessler." You can use a gun. I know we can get one. Oh, thanks, you know, you're all very helpful. Do you mind? The guy's a friend of mine. Well, he ain't no friend to me. It's genius. I've picked the wrong bottle up, that's the Baileys. Can you swig Baileys from the bottle? Of course you can. Get off it. If he drank it, it'd come through his open trachea and it would just drip all over the floor. So, not going to waste it on him, am I? But American Elf has another and better you. And it is, without a doubt, my favourite use of the word you in cinema. Complete, hands down, this even stretcho hands from like, as the hand elongates. This is the best one. And you knew it was coming. The minute I mentioned American Elf, you knew that this was going to be the you that you knew was coming. So, now we're going to go back to the start of the movie, and they're in the slaughtered lamb. Of course they are. Yeah. Oh, God. You've got, like, remember the Alamo and all that, you know. And chucks out the Mexican! And all this sort of stuff going on. Guffaw, guffaw, guffaw. Yeah. What's that star on the wall for? David Schofield, Shakespearean actor, in many movies, in the remake of The Wolfman. Turns round, our two boys and they're bubble parkers, you know, they're padded parkers. They're cold and wet, and they just want something to eat, something to drink, something hot to drink. And then you've got the tea. No. Oh. But I can make some, if you want. Well, that'd be great. Thanks very much. But David Schofield turns around. The thing is, doing it now, it feels even sort of superfluous, unnecessary. Because I've done this so many times. I've dragged this scene into so many other videos that it just seems just, come on now. We know what you're going to do. So I'm going to do it anyway. And he's missed. And everyone is silent. Even Rick Mayo's gone like that. And look, everyone's looking over like, you can hear a pin drop. And Schofield, credited purely as darts player. You made me miss. I've never missed that ball before. And you can see both of them are like really shaken by this. We've all been in pubs like this. I've talked about it a lot. We've all been in pubs where you don't belong, and everyone looks as you walk in there. Whoop, it's like they know some kind of hidden tracker's gone off, like alarm, some silent alarm. You don't belong in that place, that province. You're not from there. It ain't just the rurals of England or Wales or Scotland. It could be anywhere in the world. America has it a lot. Europe has it a lot as well. You move out into the outer environs of France. You go into rural France. You don't belong there. You will get a frosty reception. You can win it over. You can always win these things over. But it wasn't just done for the film. It's a genuine thing. It's a genuine phenomenon. And a strange face. And you know, you don't belong here. Why are you here? And especially in the Slaughtered Lamb, on this particular night, because they know what's out there. This is why, you know, an extended version of the movie would maybe be beneficial in some ways. If you listen to the BBC radio dramatisation, it explains why they know what's out there. And also, they know who the werewolf is, and he's escaped from an asylum. So they know he's out there. So it's already, this is the worst time to anyone to be here. We've just got to get through tonight. Anyway, you made me miss. I've never missed that ball before. And Schofield, it's genius. He becomes threatening. When Brian Glover is telling the Alamo joke, you can see David Glover's, because they've all heard the joke before, but they just love the telling of the tale. That's why great jokes always work, and who tells them. It's how it's delivered. And, you know, he's been waiting to chuck that dart. And he's like, he's listening to Brian Glover. And he's just going like, yeah. And he's just twizzling the dart around, waiting for the punchline, waiting for it. And then everything's great. And then, of course, the Americans go screw things up, don't they? Like, you. It's a left hand, eh?
You made me miss. I've never missed that ball before.
And he becomes very threatening. And they're like, sorry, Jack, you better go. What do you mean? I'm starving.
There's no food here, says David Scully. There's no food here.
I'm like, right, off we go. Yes, I guess we're going then. Yeah. What do we owe you?
Nothing. Go, lads. God go with you.
And then you get all the warnings and all that. And it's a brilliant sequence. It's legendary and rightly so. However, as threatening, seemingly, as David Schofield's Dark Player is in that sequence, when we meet them again, and the doctor, Dr. Hirsch, goes up there. He's been treating David in the London hospital. Goes up to check out the story of werewolves. Story of werewolves, eh? You know, I think not. And all this, I think this is the town. Is it East Proctor? Yeah, this is the town. And but Schofield's in there as well, and he's like, you know, werewolves. And he's more nervous now. He's lost all the power he had in that fair sequence. You know, he was armed with darts then, you see, like. And I, because I'll just check on the dogs, and Brian Glover's like, yeah, the dogs are fine. I'll just go check. Yeah. So off he goes into this torrential bloody rain, and like, Dr. Hirsch offers to play a game of chess with Brian Glover, who's playing against himself seemingly. And it's like, you know, fancy a game? I think not, sir. And Dr. Hirsch has asked for like a Campari and soda, and they're going like, I think not, sir, you know. a small Guinness will suffice. He has about two sips out of half a Guinness. I was like, well, it's a long way back. Obviously, he's not going to get anywhere with these people. So he's like, well, it's a long way back to London. Good day, you know, and all that. Like, and off he goes. It's two sips. You just pay for that. Fucking drink your drink, sir. And but anyway, he goes outside, and in torrential rain, David Schofield, the Dark Player, is waiting in that gorgeous, really eloquent and genuine little rural church and churchyard, in his flat cap and his raincoat, huddled up and against the rain. And like, he puts his brolly up, Dr. Hirsch, and goes over and goes like, hello. He just had a frosty response. Hello. He's like,
Tim, he's in danger. The one who survived. He'll change. Others will be killed and all that, like.
And suddenly, yeah, that's enough. And it's Brian Glover's there, like, that's enough. And David Schofield runs away, almost tripping over a tombstone on his way, you know, to get out of incrimination and stuff. The husky dog is there now, growling at me because it said tea time. Because I have overrun again.
You made me overrun.
Ooh, you shouldn't be drinking that from the bottle. That doesn't work at all. That's not as good. Well, folks, there you go. That's my top 10. And I did cheat because it's probably about, 13? Because there's three in the top slot, there's three in there. It's basically 10 movies with the word you used to a great degree. Let's go through them again. It's Conan the Barbarian, it's Rexor, when he realises, you killed my snake, you're the bastard who'll be crucified to the tree of woe, to Conan. And he's got a big axe. You. Perfect. Aliens. You know, like, Bishop doing the knife through Hudson's fingers. And like, no, Bishop, not me, Bishop, no man, not me. And Jake just goes, yeah, you. And you're like, you can all imagine yourself being in that position. Yeah, you. I've got a hiccups now. Pale Rider, Clint, and Stockburn, the corrupt marshal, who knows that he's killed Clint before. So how are you back? And he's like, when he sees under Clint's hat, the face, you. And then on his knees, pulls out the gun again, like, you. And dead. Is that RoboCop? Oh, where Officer Lewis confronts RoboCop to tell him, you know, who his true identity is. Murphy, it's you. Oh, and like Murphy takes a step back. Yeah. Does not compute, but really it does on a spiritual level. I've got memories and all that, I mean. But it's a brilliant, brilliant moment. Murphy, it's you. Because she's not asking him. She knows it's him. Mad Max 2. You can run, but you can't hide. Classic. Nicely roared and bellicose. Why is it that Vernon Wells is so threatening and so brilliant in Mad Max 2? And so really naff and comically pantomimic in Commando. We still love his version of Bennett in Commando, but he's still, it's not what it's meant to be, and he's really weedy and pathetic as a bad guy. Oh, loads of the one-liners and the quips and all that, like, and the threatening postures, but he's not believable in the least. He's camp. Mad Max Beyond Thunderdome. You. Me. You. You got a plane. I have. It might just save your life. But it's a great, you know, Gibbo comes running down and he comes to a scattering halt. He sees him. You. In their little subterranean cave, Warren. Army of Darkness. Yeah. All the multiple books of the Necronomicon, the fake books as well, and the book that bites. And Bruce Campbell, Ash is just like, oh, you, I'll get back to you. He's just, you, oh, you. Fucking love it. What's that? Predator, you know, out there, past them trees. Fantastic. Reanimator. West. What do you feel? What are you thinking? Tell me how you feel. You. You. Bastard. Fantastic. American Werewolf. Of course. The last remaining werewolf must be destroyed. It's you, David. You must die, David Kessler. Drenched in gore. You must die, David Kessler. They're all said with pointy fingers. Shut up a minute. Bloody dog. You, shut up. And then, of course, you made me miss. I never missed that bull before. That is the quintessential accusatory you. You've got the finger as well. It's like, no matter who you are, someone could shout in the crowd, you did this, you did that, you. And you're like, oh, well, could mean anyone, not me. But it's that finger. You made me miss. So folks, there you go. Please let me know what your favorite yous are. I know that Stevie Boy Doherty, north of the border, he wanted the Conan one in there. And there are enormous amounts more of these. Of course there are. I just did the 80s there without even realising it. But they're all the ones that came to me today. I thought, oh, okay. And only really sort of just before doing the video, I kind of compiled the list and wrote it all down. But there'll be millions more from probably every decade of cinematic heritage. But they're the ones that mean a lot. So you're going to come in loads and loads more. But one film there, American Elf, actually had three. And they're all terrific. So the number one slot goes to American Elf because they're all genius. They're all emphatic. They're all powerful. They're all very, very emotive. And, you know, it's you, David.
You must die, David Kessler.
But most importantly,
you made me miss.
Well, you made a big mistake there, didn't you?
Big mistakey, me thinky.
Folks, have been watching Kilt-Man, please. In the meantime, in this ever like you in between time, please keep it kilted, keep it Celtic. And let's just be happy out there. Watch out when you go into like strange rural enclaves. In America, they're full of cannibals, redneck bastards, you know. But even in the environs of North Yorkshire, which is what it's meant to be, it wasn't filmed there. I've discussed all this. But anywhere you go, you can even a city, a sprawling metropolis, you can go into the wrong side of town. And if you don't belong there, there could be a pub, a club, whatever, where it's just the locals or the local fraternity, the regulars go in there. And if you don't belong, then you don't belong. And you will get that. They will look, turn around and look at you like that. And you can, all the accusatory, you know, glances through the eyes. You don't belong here. So, but as I always say, who gives a fuck? I'm here now. What are you going to do about it? By the way, I don't advocate or encourage that sort of behaviour. Self-preservation is always the name of the game. So, anyway, there we go. Please let me know down below what your favourite yous are. And I know I've missed out millions. I'd love to know some ones from older movies, which I've completely bypassed for some reason. So let me know some like 40s, 50s, vintage stuff, like Hammer stuff. There will be some. So, anyway, take it easy. And I'm going to see you all. Wow, wow. See the pointy finger again. You.